We've got our guest ready with us. Joining us right now, we've got Parag Parekh, who's the chairman of Parag Parekh Financial Advisory Services, who's joining us on the show right now. Along with him, we've got Gaurav Kapoor, a senior economist at RBS, also who joins us on the show. Mr. Parekh, come to you first. You know, your own take on what the IIP numbers could be like, because we've got a core sector which has grown, you know, by about 5.2%, which is still lower than what May clocked in. But the overall anticipation is that it is going to be fairly flat.
If you ask me personally, I really don't like it to look at the figures on a month-to-month basis, because the trend which is important, and I think we are having a healthy growth. And I don't think we should be much worried about what the figures of months say.
Right, Parag, we'll come back to you in just a moment. But Gaurav, bringing it to you, the ET Now consensus forecast is for 5.8%, which is marginally higher than what we saw the previous month. What's the RBS forecast?
We are looking at 5.7%. The numbers is pretty much flat compared to previous month. I think you guys have already spoken about the reason, so I would not get into that. But by and large, the number looks as the headline would be flat. Typically, the index number itself between these 2 months does not change by much. So we are also expecting a flat, almost flat number.
Sure, but Gaurav, within that, for the manufacturing space, what are you expecting?
I think manufacturing will be crucial to watch, because if a headline of 5.7%, in our estimate, you will see manufacturing also pretty much around the same number, because we know electricity was at 8.2%, mining activity was subdued in the month. So it has to be, so if the headline number comes at 5.7%, if it does, then you're looking at manufacturing number anywhere between 5.5 and 6%.
Sure. Gaurav, what's the overall view now? You know, there is obviously the opinion that the top monetary policy, as well as high inflation that we are talking about, is actually hindering growth momentum, and that has been reflected over the last 2 months as well, that we've been seeing the IIP numbers coming out. What's the overall sense right now in terms of the kind of cut that we are taking on growth vis-a-vis the attempt to fight inflation and the higher interest rate that the RBI is taking on board?
I think one of the reasons why growth is slowing down is because of interest rates itself, and that's something which RBI wants to do. You want to slow down growth so that demand pressures on inflation can be managed, and the uncomfortable levels of inflation which we've seen for quite some time now can be managed and controlled. So that in that sense, I think this moderation in growth we've seen so far is something which is in line with what RBI is trying to achieve. Yes, inflation, high inflation, which has persisted for quite some time, is definitely bound to affect consumption, I think, going forward, because till now, consumption, private consumption in particular, has held on pretty strongly, pretty well. It's investment activity which has slowed down, which has been tepid. So, which actually, from a longer term inflation management perspective, is important that the activity revives. So it's been, the trend has been like this for quite some time. You've seen investment slowing down, you've seen consumption holding on fairly strongly, and that's the point which RBI made very clearly in the July policy. So so this number actually will give you a better insight as to what is happening to consumption, because we know what is happening to investment. So from that perspective, this number is definitely important.
Sure, but Gaurav, on the point that you made about private consumption, how effective do you believe all these interest rate hikes have been? Because you are seeing manufactured goods inflation running at quite high levels. It's close to about 7% now. The fact that the manufacturer has pricing power still, driven in some part by the fact that wage price inflation is holding up, in that current context, how effective do you believe all these rate hikes will ultimately be?
Well, rate hikes will go on till they become effective, and I think if you look at it, actually the monetary transmission of rates has been far swifter in this round of monetary tightening than it has been in the past. So I think you are beginning to see the impact of that now on consumption. If you see things like coincidental or incidental indicators like car sales, you've seen very sharp drop in the last 2 months. So these are signs that, you know, your high interest rates are now beginning to affect consumption. So, but at the same time, what, as you pointed out, there has been a wage spiral, there has been, you know, incomes have gone up. So there has been some absorptive capacity still in the systems, which is keeping in consumption going. But going forward, I think you will see moderation in consumption, because that's the whole idea. I mean, you need higher interest rates to curb consumption, which in turn will help curbing demand pressures and bring down non-food manufacturing inflation.
Right. Mr. Parekh, come to you. While we're talking about manufacturing capital goods, what's your own call on some of these cap good majors, an L&T, a BHEL right now, considering that the overall environment is still a little, sluggish in light of, you know, borrowing costs going up and input costs going up and their inability to maybe pass on those higher rates to the final buyer?
Well, they will go through some tough periods, but if you look at L&T's order book position, everything is good. So you're going to have always bumps coming in the way, but ultimately I'm quite bullish on the Indian economy as well as some of these majors like L&T. I don't think we should have much of a problem. We could have some bips and bumps.
And while we are on the topic of manufacturing, you know, even if you look at the auto sector as a whole, the auto sales numbers, you know, have cooled off from the peak levels on a month-on-month basis. You know, we've been seeing some bit of contraction coming in there as well. Any stocks that you would probably have a look at, or it's just going to be the frontliners like Tata Motors, Maruti Suzuki, or, you know, which ones would you probably like?
No, well, our investment philosophy is very different. So we really don't follow the automobile sector or some of the high capital intensive industries. We concentrate on something like FMCGs or something like pharmas, or we like to go in for bottom up stock picking. So where there is a value, we like to buy that.
Then, Parag, on a related note, the interest rate sensitive lot, you did hear the point that Gaurav was making, that you will see interest rates continuing to sort of bang in until you actually see some sort of a hit on consumption. In that light, how would you be playing the interest rate sensitive pack?
Well, if you ask me, I think we are really near a peaking point in the interest rates, because if you see what the Fed has said, that for 2 years in the US markets, the Western markets, they are going to have a freeze on increasing the interest rates. So it's near zero interest rates. So I think that's a very positive sign, because the commodities are cooling down. It's a very positive sign for India. And if the interest rates are up over here, you'll definitely have some money coming in over here. We'll be attracting good money.
Gaurav, when we got the IIP for the month of May at 5.6%, that's at a 9-month low. There is obviously concerns about, you know, how capital goods offtake will be hampered going forward as well. There is slower manufacturing because of various concerns, including the high interest rate regime that we are in, plus the inability to maybe pass on the entire burden of the higher import costs. What is the overall outlook and how this could pan out?
Well, I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. Are you talking about input costs, or you're talking about
IIP? I'm talking about the manufacturing sector growth and the concerns about capital goods offtake for the near term.
I think manufacturing sector clearly will slow down. You are beginning to see that, and I think that will continue for a while. On one side, clearly domestic consumption-driven or investment-driven activities consumption is now beginning to show signs of slowdown. Investments have been slow, so you will that impact on manufacturing has been visible for a while, and I think this will continue. Exports, on the other hand, have had a extremely strong run for the last 6 months, so that has been providing some support. But even there, global growth is slowing down pretty sharply. You've seen US economy slowing down, you've seen all the other major global economies slowing down, and that's one of the big, very big concerns now, that US stepping into another recession 6 or 9 months down the line. So with this kind of global uncertainty, with global growth slowing down, even exports are likely to be negatively affected, which would mean that you would see further impact on manufacturing. So hopefully, I think over the next couple of quarters, you will see manufacturing slowing down, and the impact of that on, I think, the fact that the investment environment in the country is still a little uncertain, you will So capital goods offtake will in turn also be in line with the kind of growth you've seen in the manufacturing sector. So I think we will see about next couple of quarters of soft and patchy growth in manufacturing and even capital goods.
Sure. All right, just to take a slight detour before the numbers actually come out, HDIL, they've come out with their quarterly numbers. Pull them up for you on your screens. The net profit came in at about 189 crore rupees versus an expectation on the street. They had a poll which came out with a number of 172 crore rupees, which was expected to be down from the previous quarter. Yes, it's down, but not to that great an extent. HDIL has moved up about 3.5%. The sales have come in at 512 crore rupees as well. Remember, earnings were expected to be higher. The FSI from Andheri project was to be recognized. They were to garner about 250 crore rupees in terms of their revenues from their FSI sales as well. Right now, the stock's higher by about 3.5%, but overall, versus an expectation of 172 crore rupees, they've clocked in a PAT figure of 189 crore rupees. We'll keep it with our discussion on the IIP numbers right now. Gaurav, just another word from you. Now, while we were talking about exports on that light itself, does it concern you that the Trade Secretary is saying that, we do not need to get carried away with the export numbers for the month of July, which was up by 82%, because the August to September period is going to be fairly sluggish in terms of export numbers coming in?
Right, as I said, I think global growth is slowing down. You will see the impact of that on exports slowing down as well. And I think when you're looking at these kind of numbers, 82% growth, I'm sure you have to correct for the base effect as well. There is some base effect which is coming into play with numbers, because the kind of export growth numbers we've seen so far this year, they've been extremely high. I mean, I can't remember when was the last time we saw such strong numbers. So I presume there is some amount of base effect at play as well here. But that said, a slowdown is by and large in line with what we are expecting as well. Global growth is slowing down. You've seen manufacturing sector all over the world activity slowing down in July, impact of which will be felt in August and September. You've seen consumer spending in US, consumer sentiment in US is getting hampered. Consumer sentiment in Europe is also equally shaky. So, impact of that.
All right, Gaurav, we'll just come back to you in a moment. The June IIP number is out. It's coming at 8.8%. That's a huge jump against the previous month's 5.6% and our own ETNI estimate of 5.8%. So, that's a huge positive for the markets. We don't have the internals of those numbers as yet, but what we do have is the headline number, which has come in at 8.8%. So that's a huge positive. We'll have to wait and see what the manufacturing sector number looks like. But Gaurav, just bringing it back to you very quickly, 8.8%. Your first take on it.
The number definitely is much stronger than what we had anticipated. You pointed out one. It's the unknown here is largely the manufacturing sector, and I think the manufacturing sector would have grown by over 8.5%, close to 9%. But I would say, given the kind of volatility we see in IIP numbers on a month-on-month basis, it's always better to look at numbers in a 3-month moving average, which gives a better sense of the trend. So headline number definitely is much stronger than what we had anticipated and even the consensus estimate.
All right, we're getting the internals. Electricity growth has come in at 7.9% against 10.3%. Mining growth is sharply down. It's at 0.6% against 1.4% for the month of May. But like we did mention, manufacturing is the number we need to look for. Electricity growth, like we did mention, 7.9% against 10.3%. We were expecting 8.1%. There you have it. Manufacturing growth is almost doubled, really. It's at 10% against 5.6% for the month of May. So that's the real positive within those numbers. Remember, the manufacturing sector makes up 80% of the IIP, and basic goods growth has come in at 7.5% against 7.2% in the month of May. Capital goods growth is at 37.7%. 37.7% against 5.9%. That's roughly 38%. Those are the numbers we have, but the big positives within that really are manufacturing sector and capital goods. Capital goods, I'd imagine, is the big positive, up 37%. Gaurav, your take on the capital goods specifically?
I think capital goods, again, the number definitely is very good and very strong. But the capital goods numbers have been, you've seen so much volatility in capital goods numbers that, again, I would say that it's better to correct and look at perhaps a 3-month moving average than at one only one point estimate. But that said, given that for the last 3 months or actually last 6 months or so, capital good numbers have been fairly tepid, I think this is definitely a good sign. And in fact, even the manufacturing sector number, considering what you know, you've seen the first quarter corporate results, you've seen top line growth has been fairly strong. So I think the number ties in with that overall number. I think that perhaps explains, and the fact that exports have been very strong, and I think that's showing up in keeping of manufacturing, or that this pickup in manufacturing. What remains to be seen is whether this can sustain going forward, because PMI are clearly pointing out that activity in manufacturing sector slowed down pretty sharply in July.
All right, so the main numbers have also been revised upwards to about 5.9%. But we've got two more guests joining us. Gagan Banga, the CEO of Indiabulls Financial Services, who's joining us right now, as well as Mr. Sunil Kanoria, the Vice Chairman of Shree Infra, who's also here with us to discuss the IIP numbers. Mr. Banga, come to you first. A surprise on the upside, 8.8% on the overall IIP numbers, but the key contribution this time has come in from manufacturing and mainly capital goods, which has grown by about 37.7%.
Yeah, it's quite a positive surprise, and you know, one would need to look at these numbers in greater detail to figure out whether there is some sort of a base effect playing out, or you know, where exactly have capital goods grown. But my sense is that on the back of exports, you know, the exports number reported yesterday was also reasonably good. My sense is this IIP growth is more export driven than internal. Internally, what one has been reading and hearing about, and also within the business group, what one sees is that there is some sort of a slackening of demand which is happening, at least domestically.
Sure. Mr. Kanoria, should we go by face value on the numbers that have come out, particularly from the capital goods space, 37.7%, considering in the past it's been a very volatile time for capital goods and the kind of numbers that have come out in terms of growth for capital goods? And do you also believe that there's still domestic demand pressure coming in, and this is mainly the export-driven growth that's showing up?
No, I think the way I would look at it is that this only reflects that the fundamentals of the Indian economy is strong. It has got certain negative connotations, primarily because of the interest rate increases happening and the governance issues, etc. But I think if these issues in terms of governance, in terms of reform processes are made positive, I think the economy would be fairly back in track, and it can even has the capacity to absorb a little higher interest rates. I would not be too perturbed about that, but my basic concern would be if the reform process and if the governance issues are not taken care of fast, and the government is started to talk about that, and if that happens, I think the fundamental of the economy would take it forward.
So Sunil, are you saying that, you know, it is inertia on the part of the government on the policy front that is in large part, you know, driving a lot of the slowdown that we are seeing? It's not only interest rates.
I would say the interest rate and the economy can absorb, and in a high growth economy, when and the challenges are, the inflation is primarily because of demand constraints, the supply constraints, and therefore if you have adequate reform processes and all there and opportunities there, many of this interest rate issue can get resolved over a period of time.
And
that is the reason why if you see the capital goods growth, at times it happens, in some months it comes down. That will have a jigsaw, because capital good is itself a jigsaw in nature. So that's basically a trend which is seen, where projects are there, it will go up and then it will come down.
Sure. Gaurav, coming back to you, you know, while we were on the topic of, you know, capital goods and the other manufacturing segment which has contributed this time around as well, what's your own sense about the growth potential going forward? And also right now, with the number of 8.8% that's come in for growth, does it probably, you know, give RBI one more, you know, safe point where they say, okay, now growth is also not suffering, so we can go ahead with our tightening measures without thinking twice?
Actually, from RBI's perspective, as they pointed out in the July policy very clearly, their concerns on the growth front are not as, they definitely do not seem or seem as concerned on the growth front than they have seen, than the kind of concerns they shared about the inflation side, especially short-term inflationary pressures, especially, you know, they very clearly pointed out in the near-term inflation can remain higher than anticipated, and even their March end forecast was revised from 6% to 7%, which is actually fairly significant. So I don't think that this number definitely adds to the point that RBI has been making, that growth driven by domestic consumption to some extent and supported by external demand has not slowed down yet. So that is something, or has not slowed down sharply enough. It's been a narrow based slowdown. So that I think will keep the RBI focused on managing inflation, and I think the stance is unlikely to change in the September policy. The outlook on the sector, on manufacturing sector and industrial production in general, as I said, I expect things to slow down. I expect over the next couple of quarters you will see manufacturing sector growth slowing down, because the impact of higher interest rates and inflation is bound to affect consumption, and I think there are signs of that already happening. Investment activity, despite 1 month's number, in general has been subdued. There are reasons to believe that activity is improving. I don't think it's changing the situation the situation is changing in a big way. And exports are likely to slow down. External demand growth is likely to slow down. So if you put that all together, I think next 2 quarters or so you can see manufacturing sector growth slowing down. And I think a lot depends now on the global uncertainties which we are facing, and especially on the global growth front.
Right. Now, Parag, you did make a point a little earlier that, you know, capital goods stocks particularly look, you know, they still look like a good story. Based on the numbers that we've seen come out today, would you, you know, actually increase, you know, would your bullishness on capital goods the space increase?
The first is, you cannot, make an investment decision based on monthly number which comes, you know. So now for me, had it been 10, it is 8, it would have been even 4. It would make a difference, you know, because when you are in the investment game, you are looking at a good value which emerges in bad times, and all these things can keep the traders happy, but from an investment point of view, these figures mean nothing.
All right. Mr. Banga, come back to you. While you were talking on the aspect of investment, which is still not picked up, the investment cycle is still, you know, on the downtrend because of high borrowing costs or whatever the reason may be. You've not seen that much of money or funding going into probably building up capacities, and, you know, your probable expansion plans will be on a hold because of the higher funding costs. Is that a big hindrance for you, and do you believe that could change anytime soon? Because it doesn't look likely, since the RBI is going to be keeping a fixed stance on curbing inflation and increasing rates.
No, it is definitely a very big issue. Interest rates at these levels make a lot of projects, very difficult to debt finance. The DSCR components go down. People's confidence level is down. There are scandals after scandals which keep emerging, and that also weakens the sentiment. And all of this is becoming a fairly deadly cocktail in terms of supply side constraints continuing. So while interest rates and monetary policy over the short term will perhaps break the inflations back, and we will in a couple of months probably see inflation coming back to more comfortable levels of around 6% to 7%. But structurally, as an economy, I don't think we are doing enough to keep inflation under check over the long term. Every 2 years of growth of over 8% lands us up in a soup in terms of inflation. We've not been able to break the cycle of 2 years of growth and then 1 year of hyperinflation and interest rates now. And that can only break once the investment climate is improved over a period of time, and that requires benign interest rates, that requires economic policy which is moving at a faster pace, and that also requires a far more positive sentiment to be prevalent across the economy. So unless there is significant improvement, we will have an odd IIP number which is interesting, we will have some months of inflation, which is low, but structurally we will keep struggling.
But now, Sunil, bringing it to you, when you talk to people in the infrastructure sector, what do they tell you is the single biggest factor holding them back from investing?
See, there are basically, I would say, two factors. One is the government initiative in terms of the reform process in many areas, whether it is in the power area to ensure that whether the raw material of coal or gas is available. In the road sector, the challenge becomes in the debt side. The interest cost doesn't allow projects to be viable and to be able to raise the funding which is required. So basically, all in all, in the infrastructure space, there are challenges people are witnessing, and therefore going fairly far more conservative.
Right. Parag, you know, while we're talking about all the internals of the IIP numbers and what they mean for the industry as a whole, from an investment point of view, you know, you want people to come into the markets and to invest in quality stocks where the growth horizon seems to be, you know, clear. What's in your sense in terms of picking stocks right now which can give you that upside and give you a promise of growth? Which sectors and which stocks could you probably look at?
See, here there's one issue about inflation which everybody talks. Now, we all know that stocks are the best hedge against inflation. So in a good in an inflationary situation, stocks like of FMCG, pharma, you know, they serve as a good hedge against inflation. Now, as I told you, we really concentrate on bottom-up picking. So just now, there could be certain opportunities in the market where you can have some good valuations coming in. Like, for instance, if you ask me, on the I don't like infrastructure because it wants huge amounts of capital. But there's one infrastructure company like Noida Toll Bridge, which 11 years old, it's paid off practically most of its debts. And today, it is a good business to buy. The book value is around 23, you are getting the stock at around 22. So there are so many opportunities which come. It's not that you go in for a specific sector or something like that. Mm-hmm. When the sentiment in certain sectors become weak, you get opportunities.
All right, that's the word coming in there from a market point of view. Mr. Kanodia, just one final word from you, you know, before we let you go. While you have mentioned two factors that can be hindrances for the overall industry point of view, you know, we've been seeing that in terms of while funding also seems to be a little far-fetched, you've got other concerns like, you know, interest rates, which obviously you have to fund your debt. So that's one big concern. We've not seen execution is another risk there. What is your outlook in terms of the industry growth rate that we can clock maybe from the next three quarters to come?
Well, I think the manufacturing, as other colleagues have said, that I think in the next few one or two quarters, we'll definitely see the slowdown because the impact of whatever has been happening in the last few months would see in the manufacturing sector too. It is to be seen again in terms of the consumption patterns, because with the interest rates high, the consumption of consumer goods and durables comes down. So I would see, tend to agree that we will see some ups and downs and slowdown unless certain structural changes are done and the sentiments are back overall.
All right, Sunil Kanodia, thanks very much for coming in and talking to us about the outlook for the infrastructure space and also the challenges faced in that segment. Gagan Banga, if I could just bring it to you, on India, at India Bulls Financial, are you beginning to see a marked slowdown in demand for credit from customers?
In the SME segment, there is some sort of sluggishness on the credit growth side. Home loans, since we have a moderate type of a market share, we do about 500-600 crores a month, as against the industry at about 12,000 crores. Our numbers continue to be reasonably healthy. So, you know, the growth projections that we had given at the start of the year of 30%, we will definitely achieve overall credit growth of 30%. But what one is sensing in the overall industry is that on the manufacturing side, on the SME side, there is some sort of sluggishness. And similarly, on the commercial vehicle side also, there are concerns about buying new commercial vehicles at the kind of interest rates which are prevailing now.
All right, Mr. Banga, just stay on with us. We've got Surinder Kapoor, the CMD of Sona Coil, who is joining us from New Delhi. Mr. Kapoor, thanks very much for being with us. Your initial take on the growth numbers, which has surprised the street on the positive side?
Well, I think if you look at the first quarter results of most corporates, there has been healthy growth on the top line, so it didn't come as a surprise to me. What was surprising was the April and May numbers. But I think it's fair to say that due to monetary policy, interest rates going up, there is a forecast that the next two quarters may not be as strong as the first quarter was. But having said that, I think from an investment point of view, and I can see that in our industry, in the automotive industry, there are substantial investments taking place because we are investing for the future. Yes, the interest rates are high currently, but I think most of us are into flexible interest rates. Therefore, interest rates by the time we get into production hopefully will come down, and therefore the returns would be as we expect when we first foresaw the investment climate. So, all in all, yeah, I'm happy to see the manufacturing sector having grown at 10% as per the figures just given out. And frankly, you're seeing a 50% growth in June over May and the IIP numbers, which is good.
Right, but Mr. Kapoor, you know, nobody expects the interest rate hiking cycle of the RBI to stop anytime soon. And we've seen the impact of that play out on a number of sectors in terms of demand, the automobile sector having been one of them. We've seen automobile sales month on month beginning to decline. In that light, should we expect that the outlook for automobile sales, at least over the next 6 months, is going to be remain a little bleak, and also for companies such as yours?
Well, look, yeah, there has been a slowdown, no question, but there's still a growth. And I think the important point is that we grew last year at about 30%, 28 to 30%, and this year we expect to grow at maybe half that number. So there is a slowdown, no question about it. But on the other hand, I don't think we are at least not seeing negative growth. Therefore, I still feel, and we've seen this over the years, you do get a couple of years of good growth. There is a slowdown in the third year, and I think these cycles will continue. Look, we still need to improve our supply side. I mean, we need to invest in infrastructure in the country in a big way. I mean, those things are still not happening to the extent that it should. So I guess we're going to live with a seesaw to some extent.
All right, Mr. Kapoor, thanks very much for coming in with your take on the June IIP numbers and also the outlook for the automobile sector. We've also got Mr. R.K. Bakshi of Bank of Baroda joining us on the show. Mr. Bakshi, to begin with, we've seen a big jump in the numbers. How much credibility, firstly, would you attach to these numbers? And also, if you could take us through what the credit growth outlook and the recent credit growth experience for Bank of Baroda has been.
The numbers are definitely, they look much rosier than what we had factored in. In fact, our house view was less than 5% for this month. So at 8.8%, it looks very laudable. I will not put any question marks on the credibility of the number. The heartening thing in this, if it is correct, is the capital goods number at 37.7%. But that may be, in fact, in the last few years, few months, we have seen tremendous amount of volatility in these numbers, and that is where I don't know whether month to month numbers are giving us the right picture. So it may be because of some bunching that might have happened in this particular month. That 37, by the way, 37.7% in this climate looks means I'm not putting doubting the credibility of the numbers, but it might have been due to some exceptional factors like bunching of certain things that might have coincidentally happened. But overall, 8.8% and capital goods at 37.7% for whatever reason, it's quite good. As far as credit is concerned, credit definitely has been sluggish. But then last year, if you also we look, first two quarters, the credit was very sluggish. First quarter is always the lean season. Second quarter, because of monsoon, is again a lean season, with a lot of infrastructure credit being committed, and infrastructure the product outlays become slower in this month. We have also seen that the from concept to implementation, the project periods have become much longer. It's heartening to read from the press report that government is trying to speeden up the reforms and therefore things might start happening, but there's an overall concern about everybody about implementability of projects in a faster time. Bank credit availability, like some speaker on your bus telling about, I think cost of credit is not that much of an issue. If you look at road projects bidding, it's very interesting to find that L1 and L2, somebody is asking for negative gap funding and the other is giving a positive this thing. So there's tremendous gap and the perception of the people who are bidding for that also. Credit costs will, these are typically very long term projects, 15 year, 10 year, whether it's a housing loan or whether it's an infrastructure project. So credit costs will even out over the period. Those who have taken housing loan at 7% today, they are paying 10.5%. Those who borrow at 10.5, they are actually taking a better assessment of their repayment capacity, and the rates are going to go down after that.
Mr. Bakshi will just
so come. I think it's as good a time to commit as.
Right. We'll just come back to you, Mr. Bakshi, for your comments as well. Parag, just one final word for you. You know, while we've been factoring in and we've been trying to digest all the internal numbers that have been coming out, export numbers, IIP numbers, monsoon, inflation, what is that you are watching out for before you start going big in terms of investment in the markets? Even the global environment right now seems a little uncertain.
Looking forward for bad times, because that's where you get your right investments.
All right, so at this point, no cherry picking, waiting it out till it finally gives you some direction and then starting to invest. Parag, thanks very much
Thank
for
you.
Joining in on the show as well. Gaurav, one quick word from you as well.